As with all our symposia, we move from the media and the arts to the science, to the law, to the policy, and then to case studies. Our next case study is on glacial melt in Peru with two wonderful presentations. Professor Mark Carey, the University of Oregon. I think he may be our only second environmental historian who we've brought to a symposium, and I would like to do this more and more. His research is focused on the modern history of climate change. He's written extensively on the Peruvian Andes. His historical research is interdisciplinary, and I would be very proud of many of his awards, but one of them was the Leopold Heide Prize as the best article in the Environmental History Journal on the history of ice, how glaciers became an endangered species. He will be followed by the person who traveled the longest and has still a wonderful spirit last night and today, Mr. Cesar Portocarrero Rodriguez, who is a glaciologist and civil engineer at Peru's National Water Agency. He has told stories, and if you look at your materials, you see how difficult some of these stories must be for him to tell about engineering interventions to address some of the problems we are facing with glacial melt and sea level rise. Some of the figures in the summary of his work are absolutely devastating, including the 1970 disaster near Yungue, where 80,000 inhabitants were buried by a flood. So we will start off with the overall historian perspective, and I pass the mic now to Professor Carey.
There's been a fair amount of talk today about trying to integrate the social science with the science. And so what Cesar and I decided to do to actually put our money where our mouth is to actually combine our presentations and do this together. Me as a historian, as you know there, and I've worked in the region for about 10 years, have a book about the glacier hazards and partially draining this dangerous glacial lake in the 1980s and many others. So we thought the best way here would be to integrate these two, and we're going to talk about hazards, disasters related to glaciers as a consequence, and water use as another one. And so we'll be going back and forth. Hope it's not too much of a schizophrenic talk here. But we'll keep going back and forth to do it. So I'm going to pass it over to Cesar to start.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you to the organizers to invite us to be in this very important symposium. What we want to show you is how the Peruvians started to work around 70 years ago to fight with the problems of glacier retreating, the big avalanches and the gloves, the big avalanches that we have in many lakes. Peru is located in the western and central part of South America and has 71% of the tropical glaciers. In 1989, we made the first glacier inventory with the photographs, aerial photographs taken in 1970, and we got 2,041 square kilometers. Now, the area has been reduced around 30%, and now we have only 1,400 kilometers of glaciers. These glaciers are distributed in the eastern part, central part, and western part of the Peruvian Andes. In small portions that we have there, in the north part, in the central part, and in the southern part. There are 19 portions of the Peruvian Andes where we have glaciers. And we have studied some representative glaciers distributed, as you can see, in many parts of the country in order to know which was the mass balances, which is the mass balances, then the speed of the glacier movement, and finally the data that we already know in this time is the glacier retreating rate. These are in this satellite image the glaciers that we monitored, and I will say in advance that the results are that in the 1970s the glacier retreating rate was 7 meters, in the 80s was 20 meters, in the 90s 24 meters, and in the 2000s 25 meters. But it seems that in this decade, that rate is going to change. The next monitoring will be showing us what's going to happen.
So we've heard some about glacier disasters today, and no place in the world has suffered through glacier disasters like the Cordillera Blanca area in Peru, where a total of about 25,000 people since 1941 have died in two different types. I'm sorry, this is in Spanish here, but aluvión is a glacial lake outburst flood, and avalancha would be the avalanche, not surprising. So down here at the bottom, that is really the big one. That the huge number that we get there is 55,000 died in an earthquake that unleashed that avalanche from Mount Huascarán, and then another 15,000 died in the avalanche that day. But you can see that these go back
no deaths in
a long
least,
time. We could add some other very recent, but they also go back, and you might notice that 1725
as last year.
That's even
not on
before
this list.
The end of the Little Ice Age, so we don't really know much about that. And I've really scoured for records and haven't found much. But they start picking up in the late 19th century as glacier retreat begins after the Little Ice Age. And then they really pick up, and it's the big ones in terms of glacial lake outburst floods are the mid-20th century. And then they begin a program to start draining the lakes, and that's what stops a lot of the disasters from occurring from that. So that one, the really big one in terms of the glacial lake outburst flood, I believe this is the most deadly glacial lake outburst flood in history. This is 1941. 5,000 people died on just a few days after, 6 days after the Pearl Harbor bombing. Actually, people in Huaraz initially, I found some newspaper reports, people wondered if it was the Japanese actually who had bombed the lake to cause a flood. Obviously, not the case. So something else was happening. But let me just quickly point out here that when that flood occurred in 1941, there was about 30,000 people living in the area, and this is the zone that they were in. Nowadays, if we look at that, it's up to 150,000 people, and you can see quite a bit of them are there, and they're in that zone coming down the river. We have a lot more people living in that. And the lake, Paucacocha, it emptied in 1941. It was further drained artificially right after it. Then it was drained again in the 1950s. Then it was drained and dammed again in the 1970s. And it caused a small overflow in 2003, and it once again now has a massive amount of water. It's up to 17 million cubic meters of water, which is more than it had in 1941. So it continues to be a real risk. Runrayurca, this is the first major avalanche. 4,000 people died here. This is where the city of Runrayurca was in 1962. This is where Yungay was that was spared at that time, but then 8 years later, the avalanche came down and went up and wiped out Yungay as well. So you can see these are pretty, the scale of these kind of disasters is unbelievable. Some of the things that the scientists and engineers who have been looking at these things over time, there's a variety of characteristics that they've tried to examine to check on the glacier, which ones are the dangerous ones, and then taking some actions to lower them on the lake, on the moraine dam, and then downstream characteristics to figure out which lakes are the most dangerous. There's hundreds of lakes in the Cordillera Blanca, so it's a question of identifying.
Then after the disaster of 1941 that destroyed Huaraz City, then the town, the people demanded to the government to create an office to start to work and to fight against the problems that the hanging glaciers and the avalanche or the lakes were doing. Then in that time, in 1940s, with the tools that they have in that time, they started to make the assessment of the dangerous lakes. And in this picture, you can see the main items that have to be evaluated, have to be assessed to determine, to define the danger, the hazard of each lake. First, the glacier mass, how is the glacier mass, the thickness, the volume, if it is crevassed, very cracked. The slope of the bedrock, we know that for temperate glaciers that we have in Peru, then the slope of things 24 degrees is dangerous because it could cause the slide of the glacier and provoke an avalanche. After the geometry and the slope of the internal slopes of the moraines, it's important because it's possible to produce landslides here and produce the outbursts of the lakes. The structure of the moraine, the kind of material that we have in the moraines, if it is well consolidated or cohesive material or not, in some cases it's a very sandy material, very loose, and it's possible that it could be landslides and the water could be eroded easily. Then the length of the valley below the lake downstream, because if the valley is long and a gentle slope, then the energy, the kinetic energy, could be dissipated. Then the presence of hanging glacier like this is important, because after glacier retreating, the hanging glaciers are very easy to fall on the lake and provoke an outburst. The hydrology of the catchment is important to know how much is the hydrology of the catchment in order to design the pipe that could be put after to drain the lake. And at the end, the volume of the water is the variable that we use to manage it, to drive. In the most of the cases, we drained the lake and reduced the volume in order to reduce the risk. The methods or the procedure that we used was in loose material to make open cuts, in V-shaped cuts, to lower the level of the lakes 15 or 20 meters, depending on the amount of the volume of the water. And after, to build a pipe, usually 2 meters diameter, of reinforced concrete to avoid the rise of the level of the water again. And after to build that pipe, we use it to rebuild a dam, an earth dam, or to restore the dam in order to, this dam will be against the waves that the avalanche produce in the lake. In the case of the rock dams, we used to drill tunnels. For instance, in this case, this is a tunnel of 150 meters in a lake named 513. It doesn't have a name, only the inventory number. And the biggest work that we made in Parón Lake, which has a total volume of 79 million cubic meters, we have to drill a tunnel 1,500 meters and connect with the lake 54 meters below the surface in order to drain the lake, but at the same time to use as a reservoir that lake. In this picture, you can see some of the works that we made. In total, we made 35 works in all the Cordillera Blanca that has an extent of 180 kilometers and has 830 lakes, bigger than half hectare.
Just going to mention that you can see from this map, what I did here is put the communities nearby, right below all these projects. And so the Glacial Lake Security projects, that was the one of the measures they took to partially drain the lake to reduce the threat of an outburst flood. And it's pretty much above every major town down this valley where they've done these projects since the 1940s, but in particular since the creation of an agency in 1951 that's still running up until today. Like I mentioned, the story is certainly not over, and part of the reason is, and to again mix here the human with the physical dimensions of the problem, is that you have 250,000 people living in the valleys below this. And so you have not only an exposed population, So in disaster talk, we would say there's exposed, which is physically being in the area of a flood or an avalanche. But then in addition, we're talking about highland Peru, which means that there's many other constraints, such as poverty, lack of infrastructure, lack of relief efforts, lack of government structure, lack of government stability over the long term. This creates a much more vulnerable population than you might have in, say, Switzerland or Norway or the United States, where you have a much stronger infrastructure to deal with that. So there's the human component here that's the vulnerable. And things are really changing in these lakes. Now, here's two examples. The one on the left is Lake Palcacocha. This is the one that originally flooded in 1941. And I said in 2003 it overflowed, and it broke this security dam in half, essentially. So the dam actually worked. It prevented a bigger flood from going into Huaraz with 100,000 people down below and held that lake. But the glacier tongue back here continues to move back at an incredibly fast rate. And so now this lake, in the 70s, it had, I think, 400,000 cubic meters of water, and now I said it's up to 17 million. So that's really changing really fast, and you've got over 100,000 people living downstream. This is Lake 513 that was drained with these four tunnels that were put in between 1989 and 1995. In 2010, a big chunk of ice fell off a glacier up above, splashed into the lake, created that was a 25-meter-high wave that washed over the top of this rock dam. They thought, first of all, there's 20 meters of freeboard. Second of all, it's 20 meters of space, but the wave came right over the top of that and caused a flood in Carahuas downstream from that. So even lakes that have been controlled once through a project, or like Palcacocha three times in the past, those are still really dynamic and really changing fast, so you have to keep up with that. Also, there's new lakes forming all the time.
This picture shows the Parón Lake that I showed before, where we drilled the tunnel, 1,500 meters. Then we lowered the level of the lake 20 meters, leaving a freeboard of 15 meters. But unfortunately, as Mark said, the story is not over, because now we have another lake over this lake, and it seems that this lake is going to be 1 kilometer length, 400 meters width, and perhaps a depth of 50 meters. Then the volume will be around 20 million cubic meters. Then we have to start to think what to do in the near future. I mean, next 5 years, how to drain this lake to avoid problems against this lake where we worked before.
Peru, in this case here, is kind of the inverse of the usual problem. We could think on a global scale that Peruvians might be poorer and more vulnerable than other places. But within this specific region, you actually have the wealthiest people living along the streams and along the Santa River down below. And so it's actually, in some cases, it's the wealthiest population who historically have been the most vulnerable, and the indigenous population living up on the hills up above it. Not always, because there's increasing urban migration and those people are moving into the areas, the riparian zone outside cities. But it's an interesting case that it's not so cut and dry with that. Okay.
We were thinking about the risk management and how to reduce the risk of this dangerous lake. But now with the climate change, we have to think also in the water management. And the population in 40, 50 years ago accepted to drain the lakes. But now they say, and what about the water? They don't allow us to drain the lake freely. Then in this picture, you can see that Peru has three regions: the coast, which has the larger population density, but the least water amount, only 1.8% of all the water that we have in the country. By the other side, the mountains and the jungle, the Amazon basin, have minor population density, but a big amount of water. But now we have a new problem with the water management, because the government and the decision makers, they say we have to take the water from the Amazon basin to the coast, because the lands of the coast are flat and perhaps good for agriculture. But now there are conflicts about the water use, and these people don't want to take the water from this side to the coast. That's a new problem now in this time of the climate change. About glacier retreating, I should say that these are all the portions of the Peruvian Andes that we have glaciers. And as you can see in this part, in this column, the percentage of the glacier retreating, the area that we lost, is different. For instance, for the Cordillera Blanca, which is the largest portion of glaciers in the country, has lost in the last 40 years 34%. But there are other parts of the country that are lost also 92%. Then there are two problems that we have to face in the future. One is the presence of more hanging glaciers making dangerous lakes, and at the same time about the water problems. In these two slides, we can see how our glaciers are disappearing in many pictures. The glacier called Brogy already disappeared, Lake Chacaltaya in Bolivia. And this is another glacier, representative glacier that we have monitored, that also is almost disappearing. In this graph, we can see that not only glaciers are retreating, are vanishing, but also in some parts of the country, the rainfall is decreasing. As the IPCC said that in the mid-latitudes and the tropics, perhaps in some places there are going to be less precipitation. This, we are facing also this problem. In the Santa River, which has the most regular flow in the Peruvian coast, we can see that before 1976, the trend of the precipitation was this, and after 1976, is this the trend. So it is decreasing the precipitation. And at the end, the total mass, the total volume of the river, also before 1976, has this trend, the total volume that was delivered to the Pacific Ocean, and now it is decreasing. I have to mention now that there are many coincidences that this morning one of the speakers said about the PDO. For instance, we have we found that the precipitation started to change in the mid-70s. The same way the glacier retreating was accelerated in the mid-70s. Also yesterday, Mr. Rafael Torres talked about that the least precipitation in the Sacramento Valley was the least precipitation was in between 1976 and 1977. Then perhaps the PDO is going to be a big driver in the climate in this part of the Earth.
But the importance of the water in particular in this region is, in part, it's the seasonal flow, and it's the dry season when you really need the water coming from glaciers, because the glaciers provide, like we've heard, just like snow, that's the reservoir, it releases water in the dry season. So that's the real key. May to September is when it's important. Another important thing to mention is just that hydroelectricity in the Andes, not just in Peru, is incredibly important as a source of energy. So that's a big thing. And in Peru, increasingly, export agriculture is a huge part of their economy, and a lot of that is coming from glacier meltwater as well. So it's a variety of reasons that it's important. One thing I want to emphasize here, though, is that most studies and most money going into research is being based on how much water is available and how that will change. What I mean by that is, if the climate changes under certain scenarios, what will the size of the glaciers be and how much water can we expect to come out of them? That's where most of the research has been focused on that. What I've looked at from the human side is that in the past 50, 60 years, what we're seeing is maybe a slight increase in water availability, water supplies, water runoff coming from glaciers, maybe about average, and more recently, a decline in that. But during that same 50 or 60 years, if we turn away from looking at just availability of water and look at use of water and the management of water, we see a completely and utterly different scenario, which is astronomical increase in water use throughout the Santa River Basin, which to me then makes me think we really need to be merging this study of how much water is there and how are people managing it, how are they using it, how is it being distributed. And that, I think that my sense is that most scientists quickly recognize that they want to do that and know that that's an important variable, and social scientists are not really stepping in. I used to blame it on something else, that we emphasize science too much, but I've seen every scientist who I interact with who really wants to know that and are really eager to collaborate and reach out, And my colleagues don't seem to be doing that necessarily in history and sociology, anthropology, more and more, but much less than the scientists. So what do we get if we look at this scenario? Hydroelectricity in this is huge. On the Santa River that drains about 70% of the meltwater from the Cordillera Blanca, there's the Cañón del Pato hydroelectric station. It's the seventh largest in Peru. You can see from 1958, before it was built, obviously there was no output of hydroelectricity, and now it's up to 263. That has changed over time, as you can see, but the big boost came after 1996 when a U.S. company, Duke Energy, bought it and had the capital to invest in it. What does this mean? This means if we look at neoliberalism as ideas and policies, and we look at technology and we look at management on there, those actually turn out to be much bigger factors influencing the water regime than climate change or glacier size or anything like that. Within reason, if the glaciers disappear 100% or reach a threshold, we're onto something different, but we're not there. Coastal irrigation, we can make a similar claim here that 1958, the best estimates for this lowland area that I can find is that it was about 7,500 hectares irrigated. After the 1980s, when the Chavimochic and Chinecas projects were started, now we've got up, 175,000 hectares, a massive increase. The size of the Santa River watershed has increased through this mother canal down there. That takes water way far north to all the way up to the city of Trujillo. So it's a pretty amazing change down there. Again, the politics behind this, and it's the APRA government, which I won't get into, who have really pushed these projects forward, but we're looking at very different forces and a different trajectory of water use in that area. Urban potable water consumption, this is just urban supplies. You can see in the last 10 years, they've changed pretty dramatically. And in Trujillo, nothing coming from the Santa River before the 1980s, and now up to 70% of its supply. What you can see from those, again, is the importance of, if we just look at water availability, we see a decline over 50 years, and if we look at water use, we see it shooting up. So how do we reconcile those two different curves, and how do we bring those together? A lot more conversations like we're having today.
To summarize this presentation, that saying that I am completely convinced also that social scientists and scientific and natural scientists have to work together, because I think this is more a social problem than a scientific problem, because technological problems could be solved easily in these small machines, but this thing is very difficult to change. That's what why I would like to summarize, saying that the work in Peru, the fight against the dangerous glaciers and the dangerous lakes, started in 1941 with the tools that we had in that time, and also at this time, we started the glaciology research to measure the mass balance, the glacier retreating, and the glacier movement speed. The second stage was after the earthquake, that some of the works that we made in this time were destroyed or cracked, so we have to repair those works after the earthquake in 1970. In that time, we started to make the glacier inventory that is updated currently, and the lakes inventory for the water management. And now, in view of the presence of the climate change, of course, we have to change also the procedures. And in the last two decades, the people do not accept to make the works in the lakes without thinking in the water management. And that's why we have to face the glacier retreat and lake growth, increase the glacier avalanche, combining risk management and economic development, or plan. We have to make a developed planning. We made 35 security works and the need to redesign the security works. What adaptation means from the glaciology point of view and of the reality of my country? First order, we have to reduce the risk of the dangerous lakes in order to prevent, to save the lives and the public and private property. Take into account the integrated water resources management, which is important for the future of the country, and involve human population. Short time ago, we were talking, and we said that the project should not appear. They have to be negotiated. We cannot go to the people and say, look at, I have this project. What do you think about? I think that's the wrong way. What we have to do is to make the dialogue and to talk with the people and combine ideas to make a project sustainable. Thank you.
Thank you.